So, welcome to another edition of
Tools and Tea Time
with Tim and Anna.
on Tuesdays.
Okay, well, we are so glad that you all joined us today. We have an exciting guest to present with you today. And you know, this is tea time, which is just like tea with a friend, we like to say, except you never know, since we're on Zoom, maybe Queen Elizabeth herself might show up here to have tea with us. So, without any further ado, we're going to take a second to kind of remember it's the end of the day. And Anna, you want to take this away?
Yes, we are going to do some five finger breathing. And this is just another way to help you or your students with some stress reducing breathing exercises. We're watching a little video, right, Tim?
Right. And it is the end of the day. So we know that everybody's got to shake off all that from the day. So all you have to do is follow along with the video. And we're probably going to do it a couple more times after the video. So even after the video stops, keep doing the breathing. Okay, here we go.
Now let's add breathing as you trace your fingers. And this time we're going to pause at the top of each finger. So starting back at the base of your thumb, breathe in all the way through your nose as you trace up. Pause at the top and breathe all the way out through your mouth as you trace down. Be sure to take your time. You don't need to rush. When you get to your pinky, trace your finger all the way down to your wrist.
Keep it going.
All right, so we're gonna go breathe in, hold it, breathe out. 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 All right, let's do it one more time. Go back to your thumb, up to the top of your thumb, breathe in, hold it, breathe out. 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 Breathe in, hold it, breathe out, and shake your hands. And we're very relaxed now. Okay.
Yeah, so you can add this to your repertoire. A couple of weeks ago, we taught teachers about stress and how you can get rid of stress, especially when there's so much going on. So we have, of course, our usual email from our imaginary fan base. And Rodney writes this week saying, "Hi, Tim and Anna. Even with all these tech bells and whistles, I'm struggling to keep the wonder in learning. How can I get a little more of that inquiry-based I wonder into my remote lessons?" So that brings us to our theme for the week. And our theme for the week is inquiry in remote learning environments. A lot of you are going to be hybrid. Some of you are still online. But whichever way, you're going to have some kids at a distance from you. And how can you keep the inquiry live? Which brings us to the roadmap for today. If you want to give a quick review, Anna?
Yes, we're going to think about that topic. And next, we're going to do a tool highlight with Pat. Pat's our special guest, and Tim's gonna let you know a little bit about him. And we're gonna end with our favorite time, which is a community check-in, where you're gonna go into breakout rooms and connect with other educators around, the nation. So that's it.
Great. All right, so let me, without any further ado, introduce the tools Pat's going to feature are how you can use videotape demonstrations to inspire wonder and FET simulations. And our speaker is Pat Brown. He's coming to us from the suburbs of St. Louis. We are really fortunate, you know, without Zoom, it'd be really hard to get Pat here. And he's volunteering, but he's an educator and an author. Why don't you give us a hands up if you have attended a workshop with Pat at the museum in the past. Pat's done a couple workshops. I see Tracy raising her hand, Anne Marie. Okay, so I think that the fact that these people are coming back for Pat should tell the rest of us that, you know, we're really fortunate to have him. So Pat, I will shut my app and let you take it away from here. If you want to screen share, I will stop sharing. Thank you for joining us.
Yeah, so let's jump in. I am so excited to be able to talk to you a little bit about inquiry and remote learning and some ways to engage students in science. The way we sequence science instruction can be an entry point for inquiry-based learning, and it also applies to virtual learning. So I want to just kind of highlight some key things about how we sequence instruction and to show you an approach I call explore before explain teaching. So it, as the words explore before explain imply, it's really getting kids to basically do science to learn science. And there's three critical sort of pieces to it. First, I always start with a phase where we're eliciting students' prior knowledge. The first phase of eliciting the prior knowledge, it's really critical. It engages them in the lessons that you're going to teach. It creates that need to know the answer situation. So when you're asking questions about kids, about their prior experiences and their knowledge related to whatever you're studying, it creates some questions in their mind about what they know and what they don't know, and it sets it up really nicely. Secondly, and the second phase is really the exploration phase, is when I like to create experiences that allow students to use data as evidence for making a scientific claim. This phase is key. So here I'm tapping into constructivist ideas that basically suggest that the best learning happens when students play an active role in meaning making. This is also a very NGSS way to teach, because the only way for students to make an evidence-based claim is they've got to be able to make connections between the practices that they're using to explore science and the actual content that they're making a claim about. And then lastly, there's a phase that involves explanation. And this is where students really dig in a little bit deeper and they start to explain the underlying scientific principles. This is where I love to attach the academic vocabulary, the scientific vocabulary. With the explanation coming after students' evidence-based claims, they have a framework for incorporating that vocabulary in a meaningful way. So I always teach the vocabulary after and in light of students' firsthand experiences. So I want to illustrate how this looks in practice. And there's no way that I have enough time to like do full justice to this, but I'm going to give you a sort of a flavor of how explore before explain teaching looks. And this is an all-time kid favorite. So just to maybe set this up a little bit more for you, investigation is going to involve making ice cream, okay? And we start off with an assessment probe. And this assessment probe is very relevant for any kid in the Midwest. And I imagine it's very relevant for any kid in Denver or Colorado area too. And it basically asks kids the question, why do we put salt on the roads before a snow or ice storm, okay? So in our area, the roads are heavily salted probably 12 to 24 hours before we even get any precipitation. So it's something that they've all experienced. And typically, and this is actually a second or a third grader's answer, this is almost predominantly what I hear from kids when I ask this. You know, they'll talk about, so the roads don't get slick, so that the snow melts. But when I follow it up, it's really interesting when I follow it up about how adding salt to the water and ice, what that does to the temperature. It's very insightful what they think. So if you look real quick at my two sort of selected response or multiple choice items, first one I asked is just if I add water to ice, what's the temperature going to have? What's the temperature of the water going to do over time? So almost all kids think that the water ice, it's going to decrease in temperature. When I asked the next question, and this really involves sort of the salting of the roads, when I asked what happens when we put salt water and ice together, they say that the salt water, it's going to increase the temperature, so it's going to get warmer. And they're using that belief basically to justify why they put salt on the roads. So it would increase the temperature and melt, which logically makes sense. But the question is that really the reason why? So I have a little bit of an investigation I'm going to talk you through that explores this. And I just have to tell you up front, this is about a 16 to 20 minute investigation. I've sped it up so that you can sort of get the gist of it. There's no way you're going to see all the details of all the procedures, but I think that the data that you'll get from this is going to give you sort of enough background that you could use this with kids, okay? So what I have here is I have a coffee creamer and I just took it out of my refrigerator. And actually I took this one out of the refrigerator at the same time and I'm taking the temperature of this one and this one's on the scale and you'll notice that the mass is 15.4 grams. Okay. So I'm gonna throw this coffee creamer in a container of ice water. And I'm going to do this, I'm doing this for 8 minutes. This is greatly sped up, but what you'll notice over here is that the temperature, it decreases. Right now it's at negative 0.2. And this is probably 2 to 3 minutes into the investigation, but since it's sped up, it seems less. Okay. So after 8 minutes, I take it out, I mass it. You notice the mass doesn't change. It stays at 15.4. And after 8 minutes, it stays a liquid. Wow, not too surprising, right? Okay. So now I'm gonna do the second one. This time I'm gonna add, I'm gonna take the temperature again. You'll notice the mass is still 15.4. Still 8 minutes, but I'm gonna throw 30 milliliters of salt in there. Okay. So look at that temperature. So if you're wondering, why didn't the temperature change that much? Why did that first video seem like it went pretty fast? And the reason is because it didn't change very much. It got down to about negative 0.2 Celsius. There wasn't much change over time. This one, it's getting super, super cold. Okay. I'm going to take the mass. 15.4, mass doesn't change. And this time when I open it, you have ice cream. Kids absolutely love it. Kids can eat it. It is an absolute hook on so many levels for them to be thinking about the data and evidence. I will throw just a little bit of information out there. If they have lactose or peanut allergies, they shouldn't eat it. But most kids, if they don't have those sorts of allergies, they can eat it. So that's the gist of it, but I want to show you a student's data table because what you saw was very, very fast. That's a 3 minute video of something that takes 16 to 20 minutes. Based on the data, kids can make a lot of important evidence-based claims, okay? And remember, these are not things that I'm telling them. These are claims that students basically play an active role in constructing. The first evidence-based claim that they can make is that the mass doesn't change. So this is an important claim and also a misconception that most kids have, that they think that a solid is gonna weigh more than a liquid, when in fact, when a material goes from change of state from a solid to a liquid, the mass is conserved. And it does a nice job of showing that. The next claim that the kids can make, and this is also, you see this in the data, is I love to go deeper than just having kids sort of know the difference between solids, liquids, and gases, and really relating sort of the temperature dependency on those phases of matter. So we see definitely that there is a relationship between whether something's a solid or a liquid. I should actually probably say a liquid and a solid and the temperature of it. And it wasn't until I put that really in that super cold situation with the salt water that we formed the ice cream and we formed a solid. Another important evidence-based claim that students can make, and this is also a common misconception I'd experienced in eighth grade and then in high school when I was teaching it, is kids want to think that the more ice I add to just regular water, that the water is going to continually get colder. Part of the reason you didn't see that water keep getting colder is it doesn't. It basically just reaches close to 0 degrees Celsius. And then it doesn't continue to get colder. That's as cold as it gets before it turns to ice, okay? And then lastly, this really, it addresses the prior knowledge or the assessment probe. We don't put salt on the roads to actually warm the roads up. We put salt on the roads to cool down the temperature that it needs to actually freeze those salted roads. So if a road would normally freeze at 0 degrees Celsius or 32 Fahrenheit, when we add salt to it, it's going to be much, much lower. So the temperatures outside are going to have to get considerably colder if you want those roads to actually freeze. So I love this activity because it really hits grades 3 through 5, 6 through 8, and then 9 through 12. I have a book right here. It's called, it's What is the World Made Of? It's on solids, liquids, and gases. For the explanation phase, I use this with 3 through 5. We talk about the differences between solids, liquids, and gases. We sophisticate their understanding a little bit in terms of just a solid takes up a finite amount of space, a liquid's going to take up the space of its container, and a gas is going to take up the available space that it has. 6 through 8, I should say this too, at the elementary level too, we do go over sort of a temperature scale and Celsius and the freezing points of water, and then just other sort of benchmarks that you know about. 6 through 8 and also 9 through 12, I love to use FET because it investigates really what are happening to those molecules as we change temperature. So I'm gonna play this really quick. This is sped up too, but if you look here, I'm gonna take these molecules and I'm gonna change the temperature from 100 C down to 0 C. Just observe how those molecules change. See, first they're kind of all spread out. They have a lot of energy. They're moving all over the place. Okay. And this actually over got 0, but negative 24 C, they all got very tight together. Okay. So this explanation, though, this would definitely be something that a kid's doing. The kids are doing this, and they're trying to explain how do the molecules look different in gases versus liquids versus solids, okay? So I love this for a lot of different reasons. It's super engaging. I hate to say it, anytime you add food to something, it's just sort of that other mental piece that allows kids to sort of hook a memorable experience to. I think more importantly though, it illustrates that kids can construct robust understanding based on data and evidence. And we can use those data-based experiences to hook more sophisticated understanding. And you can do this face-to-face, but you know what? You can also do it virtually. You might not have temperature probes, but kids could do this and collect that qualitative data. They could do it, and they could make the ice cream, and they could watch a video like this or others so that they could have sort of that quantitative data to back it up, okay? So I know there's no way I could do it full justice, but I wanted to just sort of give you an inquiry tip, the explore before explain. So thinking about inquiry through sequence of instruction, and then also thinking about using videos to videotape demos, and then using things like FET so that kids can really explain ideas that are inaccessible from firsthand on their own, okay? So I'm going to stop sharing and hand it back over to Rob and Anna.
Okay, so just so you guys know, remember we say in science that science phenomena don't have to be phenomenal, meaning that like you might just, you know, shoot a picture of your door in the morning when it's cold and then take another picture in the afternoon where they can see that there's a gap between the door and the outside where light's coming in, but then there's no light coming in, and just ask them to puzzle over, so why was there light coming in the morning but not in the afternoon? Why does the door swell up? Or, you know, simple things like, you know, you turn on your stove and you watch a thermometer on the other side of the room. Why does the temperature go up on the other side of the room? How did the heat get from there over to the other side of the room? And to just start asking questions by just taking short videos with your phone of all kinds of things. Pat, do you have any advice about particular places they can go looking for videos?
Boy, you know, I think the internet is so abundant. I've become a huge fan of FET, which FET really isn't so much videos, but the nice thing is it's really manipulatable simulations, which I think is just brilliant. If I was anybody right now, if you're in any sort of face-to-face, I would be videotaping everything and include kids on it. Have kids videotape it. That's a great way to sort of build your corpus of videos for just the chance, you know, if you're in a more virtual situation than you'd like, or just in everyday sort of instruction.
Yeah. And Pat's resources and are the resources, we put them in the folder as usual, and we'll give you the link at the end of the show, and Ugo will mail it out to you again tomorrow. So we're going to go ahead and move on, because I know that you guys like, thank you, Pat. I know that you guys like to have time to process and think about what we're doing, that's really the purpose of this show. So I'm going to go ahead and let Anna take it away with the community check-in.
All right, so when you get in your breakout rooms, be thinking about how are ways that you could adapt a tool or the inquiry approach like this, like the way Pat showed to us, to continue to spark wonder in your students when you are in a remote or a hybrid situation. And you guys probably have some ideas that you can share with your friends as well. So it should be some awesome conversation.
Okay, so we're going to send you out to breakout rooms. We'll bring you back in about 5 or 6 minutes. All you have to do is hit accept when it pops up on your screen. So here we go. I'm going to ask, could breakout group number one, when you get your invitation, breakout group number one, can you not accept and stay here and have your discussion so that it gets recorded for people who watch later? Okay, so I'm going to go ahead and everybody accept group number one, hit accept. Emery and Tracy, if you could introduce yourselves to each other, and then we'll just be flies on the wall as you discuss, if that's okay.
Sure. Yeah, that sounds good. Hi, Tracy.
Hi.
So I actually just moved to Denver a few weeks ago, but I've been working in informal ed. So most recently I was at the Dallas Arboretum. So I'm still writing lessons remotely. The Arboretum, so I'm looking for ideas in these sessions.
All right, so I am teaching in Colorado Springs at Coronado High School. So I'm teaching environmental science and geology. And I actually used FET today.
Oh, how did you use it?
So in geology, we're talking about geologic time and and so today we were talking about radiometric dating. And so I was using, there's a FET simulation in there about how that all works.
Okay.
So that's, yeah. So I was using that today. And I'm thinking now, and then thinking about what Pat said and remembering how I've been in the sessions before and realizing that, yeah, maybe I should have structured that a little bit differently to make it more exploratory.
Yeah. Yeah. How would you have done it differently? Have you got
enough time? I'll probably try this tomorrow because I'll be teaching this class again with a different group of kids. I'm going to kind of restructure my my questions, I guess, to see if I can make it a little bit more exploratory. Because how that simulation works is that there's like four different stages or four different sections of the simulation. And the first one is talking about half-life. What is a half-life? And then another one talks about decay rates and showing like the percentages over how they change over time between the parent and daughter isotope. And then the last section, which is the one that I really like, is they actually get to, they have a series of objects that are buried in the ground and they have to use their little probe to find how old the object is. Hmm. So there's some different things that they need to use with that. And they can change, like for example, the isotope, because carbon-14 isn't gonna work for some of those really old objects. So they have to kind of work through it and figure that out.
Okay.
Yeah, just to add to both of your discussions, I mean, like if you're looking at, say, the isotope simulation, to just leave it so open-ended at the beginning, like, okay, go ahead and turn this on, you know, change these settings, change this, change that. What do you notice changed? Why do you think it's changing? And just letting them, without any explanation, that explore before explain, but guiding questions, like, what do you notice? Why do you think that's happening? It's simple planning, you know, it's so easy to plan. And definitely then they're more interested when you get to the explain stage because they've had a chance to make their own opinions first.
Yep.
Yeah.
Yeah, so I think, you know, tomorrow that's going to be my plan. Because I did that with my class today. It's a team talk class, so I have a lot of students in there that have IEPs. And so I did it with them. I was trying to do it with them virtually. So hopefully tomorrow it might go a little bit better. We were actually supposed to be hybrid this week, but then they decided that our ventilation system was not up to par. So what they're telling us. Oh,
yeah, that's not good news to get. Yeah.
No.
Well, just so breakout group number one knows, I closed the other breakout rooms, and so they're popping back as we speak to join us. Yeah. So thank you. Thank you for being here where the others watching the video later can kind of see what you talked about. It was interesting for me to kind of peer in. So we want to respect your time. It's right. I hear the 5 o'clock bird behind me going off. And we just wanted to say that we reached the end, my friends, and that Pat's resources are available here in the folder that we're going to show you in just a moment. There's a tiny URL right there if you want to jot it down. And also, Ugo will be sending this out tomorrow with the video link. The recording of this video, if you want to show it to friends or rewatch it, will be archived on dmns.org on our Tea Time website where you went to sign up today. Anna?
And we are very excited about our next guest on Tuesday. We're going to have Will Pierce, who is the Chief Academic Officer for 27J. You can see Melissa's happy because she works for 27J. And he is going to inspire us by sharing some decisions made by District 27J as related to COVID. So I think it's going to be a really fun time for everyone. And we're excited. So.
And we want to thank our special guest, Pat, if you can give him a little bit of applause here. Thank you, Pat. Thanks for joining us. It's an hour later there, too, and he's still at his office. We need him to get home to his family. And we hope that you guys had fun, and please tell your friends if you did, and let us know what topics would be useful to you coming up. We're Anna and I are in the throes of planning November as we speak. Yeah, let us know, or if you have a cool idea you want to share with teachers, we'd love to have you come on as our special guest. So
absolutely.
With much gratitude, here is the link. Oh, I'm sorry, Anna, I was supposed to show that picture while you were talking about our special guest. And here's the link to all the resources that were mentioned today, to FET and to other resources Pat mentioned as well. So you can write that down or wait for it to come in an email from Ugo. But we really appreciate you. Keep up the good work, everybody, informals, formals, making this world magic for kids. It's the greatest work we can do, and sometimes the most exhausting. So have another cup of tea, and we'll see you next week.
Drink up.
Thanks, guys. Bye.
Bye.